clever people, and welcome to my review for Bad Times at the El Royale. So Bad Times at the El Royale stars Jeff Bridges, John Hamm, Dakota Fanning. It's got a really good cast, and it is directed by the man who made The Cabin in the Woods, a movie I have not seen yet, but I hear great things about. And the movie follows the story of seven people that all stay at a hotel known as the El Royale. It's fallen on hard times, though. It used to be a big place to stop because it was in California and Nevada. There was a line in the middle of it, and people would stay on either side. People made songs about it, but it's fallen on hard times. There's only one person who controls everything that's going on. So people stay at this hotel, but what they realize is that there's some shady things that are going on behind the scenes. And as the movie progresses, it gets more and more complicated and more intense. Bad Times at the El Royale, I would say, was one of my most anticipated movies of October, and I think I would put it probably at the top 10 most anticipated for the rest of the year, back at the beginning of maybe even September, definitely October, but maybe even September, because I love old-style movies like this. I love movies that take place in the 40s or the 50s. I think this one's 50s, and I love styles of movies like that, and also the premise is really interesting. I love movies that take on a bunch of different characters, subplots, and tell them non-linearly and in a really interesting way, and I love plots that get progressively more complex as the movie goes on, and there's so many layers to peel back like an onion. I love movies that do that. I went into Bad Times at the El Royale with extremely high expectations, and I think my expectations were set a bit too high. Not to say that the movie is bad, though. This is a really well-made movie. I just don't think that it's quite necessarily, like, an amazing film. I think it's just really good. The positives in the movie absolutely have to do with the setting. The El Royale Hotel has such an odd energy and personality to it, and it really, really worked. And the way that all the characters interacted with each other, too, also felt very natural. Drew Goddard did a great job directing and I believe also writing this movie. Or if it wasn't him, whoever wrote it did a really good job because the conversations feel natural. And the way that the script is able to show the same scene in so many different ways is really effective. It takes on the Rashomon effect. If you don't know what that is, it's named after the movie Rashomon by Akira Kurosawa, where it's basically it's a scene and it's a bunch of different characters take on that scene. It's a lot like that. It's definitely inspired by that movie, and I think that it does it really effectively and really well. The conflict in this movie could be made into a movie that was an hour and a half, and this one's 2.5 hours, so there's an extra hour in this movie that is technically considered padding, and I think in a few instances it does feel like padding, but the way that it's so long actually is pretty effective because it makes you curious about the story. You want to know more and more about it, but the film is so long that you have to keep on waiting. And the way that the movie progresses, that makes the progression feel that much more intense because the movie is so long. It's weird that a movie can stylistically have a length that works for it, but I think Bad Times at the El Royale is one of those few movies. Now getting to the negatives of the movie, I thought that the style of the movie was a bit disappointing, and I think that was all in my expectations, because I was expecting a movie that was going to be filled with personality, but Bad Times at the El Royale is a bit more dry than I expected or even wanted it to be. I think that this movie should have been a bit more flashy, or at least flashy is what I got from the trailers, and I was hoping for a bit more of that. And unfortunately, that's not what we got. It's not a slow-paced movie, but it's not super fast-paced either. It's moderately paced, and I wanted a super fast-paced, ultra-entertaining movie, but that's not what this was. And that has to do with my expectations and all my other problems, sometimes with the pacing of the scenes, sometimes with the construction. Oftentimes, it can be related back to my expectations. But I still think that this movie is really well done, and if it's anything, even if it's not super amazing, it's memorable. It's not a movie you'll forget, and I really do applaud it for that. And another thing to mention are the performances in this movie. Part of the reason the dialogue flows so well is because the performances are so good. I would say that the standouts are Jeff Bridges and Chris Hemsworth. They both do incredible jobs with their roles, and as the twists go on, I love how Jeff Bridges' character, you got to learn more and more about his story and about the first scene and about how everything relates. It was really cool. So overall, Bad Times at the El Royale is a good movie. It's enjoyable. It's well done. I just do think that it was a tad disappointing, but I would still recommend it. I will give Bad Times at the El Royale a 7.5 out of 10. Alright, that concludes my review for Bad Times at the El Royale. So, what are your thoughts on this film, or what is your favorite movie taking place in the 50s? Comment in the comment section below and let me know. I'm Robert Burke, and this has been The Clever Critics. Goodbye.